Okay, it's 7 o'clock. We have a quorum. We'll call a planning board meeting to order. First up for general information, first is Mr. Quinlan. We have your report. You're all set.
All set. All right.
Well, you're going to, only if you want to sign. You've got to get a sign first.
All right, two of them, yeah, we sign.
We got lots 3 and 5, right?
Yeah, that's the one.
Oh, okay. You got the release covenant?
Yes.
Okay, that's what we said, right?
There it is, okay. Jimmy, probably should explain to the audience as well as some of the new members about the release and...
Yeah, one, this is a definitive subdivision, and the entire subdivision is held in covenant until, as time comes on, that lots are to be released. That's to make sure that the road and everything else is put in accordingly. And Mr. Quinlan is in here for Megan's Way?
Yes.
To release lots 3 and 5. And part of the agreement on lots 3 and 5 in a planning board vote at the last meeting, with a majority in favor to have an independent engineer review the drainage calculation because of the steep slopes that are on the, are on the property. And the engineering review came back that everything looks good. And everything should work. So we're going to sign and release it. We're going to make a motion.
I'll make a motion to release lots 3 and 5.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Lots 3.
But I get a question.
Yep.
If these lots passed everything there on the same soil, is he going to be required to, with this extra expense, to do the rest of them? Seems to me, Birkin Builders and all those guys, they don't have to do this. Why does he get a grade?
Those are flat lots, and these are sloped lots.
But, I mean, the soil is the same through this whole hill.
It's the design of the lot, the location of the structure, and... what kind of landscaping they do. So there are only 4 lots in all, I think, in the subdivision.
Yeah, but that's probably $2,000, $3,000. How much money is that going to cost you extra?
They're about $1,500 to $2,000.
Yeah. If you guys want to pay anything, you wouldn't like it.
Well, John, too, the neighbors aren't here. The neighbors had some legitimate complaints.
But the point is, his engineer, he's going to use the same engineer, and you have another guy just review it for $1,500. I think that's outrageous. Where do you sign this there, Jimmy?
Sign it right in Joe's name.
Where's Mike signing it?
Michael signed above it.
Just needs a majority. It only needs 3.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm going to notarize it.
I like him. He's a good guy.
Didn't you sign one? Yeah, you can sign above. Sign above my name.
Okay. Sign it.
Now, you sign the plans also?
Do you want it still?
Yeah, I'd like to.
You want our autographs?
Sure.
Okay.
Any particular place?
Sign it anywhere.
Anywhere.
Right.
How about... Are you signing it?
Right there.
Oh, okay.
Nice spot. Yeah, he's got a better spot.
Pick these up in my office tomorrow. I'll do the notary stamp.
Got any complaints?
No complaints.
Do you no good anyway, so forget it.
Valerie Miller. Oh, for about the handicap stuff?
Yes.
Is it required? Is handicap access required for your building?
No, a plan is required.
Oh, plan is...
So I need to have an alternative if somebody comes up with handicap access.
This is the part on it, I'm just curious.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So that I can offer alternative places to go that are handicap accessible.
Oh, okay.
So as long as I got the plan. So, all right, so...
So what's the plan say?
The plan says that I would rent a hotel room and treat the person there. That's what...
Never heard of nothing like that.
That's what he said.
What did he say?
No, that Tim offered that as a solution, and that was acceptable. So I have seven copies of the plan with the site plan and the description and the pictures of the house and all that stuff.
Okay.
The labels and the official... Abutters,
okay. Oh, here we go.
Okay, what's the street address there?
217 Middle Street.
And what kind of business is this, though?
This is a baking.
Although she doesn't like it, I'm not trying to offend you. It's like a massage business.
It's an alternative healing.
Right, alternative healing. And I do address that. Just because the state is so adamant about regulating massage, per se.
Okay.
That's why.
I need some healing, but I'm... No recovery for me.
No hope?
No.
October 18th?
Probably the 18th.
Is it possible for the 4th?
No, it's too late to get mailing labels out for them.
Oh.
Okay. We need typically, the has to be published 2 weeks ahead of time, and this is the first week that would have to be published in a newspaper, so you wouldn't make the 2 week deadline. Okay.
So we also are working on with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission on the master plan, and we set aside the first Tuesday of the month to focus on that.
Okay.
And that's supposed to be done by the end of the year, so we're in crunch time on that.
Going to call it home occupation. I don't need to put what it's called in the newspaper, so that's good.
So what you will do is take the application with the filing fee endorsed on it and one set of the description to the town clerk. You pay her and then you leave that with her so that if the legal notice is going to say if anyone wants to look at the application, it will be at the town clerk's office.
Oh, okay.
So you transfer it to her along with your check tomorrow or next couple of days.
All right. And so here are the other
copies. Yeah, we're all set with that.
I have the labels.
Yes.
I just want to make sure you got it.
Yep, you're all set.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Lane Floyd.
Good evening, gentlemen. I was here at the last meeting, August 16th, and the board had a finding for my subdivision on Knightley Road. I learned this morning from the town clerk's office that the paperwork has not been filed.
Yeah, it takes about 4 to 6 weeks to get it done.
Okay, yeah, Randy Iser suggested I come in and inquire as to
He could have told you that.
He didn't, so that's why I took the time to come here.
Yeah, it takes some time to write it up. Hasn't been written up.
Okay, very good.
By the end of the month.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Frank McNeil?
Good evening, gentlemen. I'm here to address the signage at 1012.
Oh, that's right, yep.
Russell, I've got some renderings for you. Show the front and side sign. There's no design change. It'll be exactly the same size. The only difference will be the change in the logo.
Okay. What was the address again?
1012 Russell.
You're actually going to have only one sign in the middle. You've got two.
You're going to have one or two signs.
Well, there are currently two.
Right.
So if there's one, that's fine. We don't need two. We were just going to do exactly what was there now. Pretty much to cover up the... So we didn't have to paint.
You could put on two sides. There's one on the side here.
Correct, yeah.
And the front one.
I flipped on the second page. It shows this side.
So, which one do you want? Do you want both or do you want one? You will be allowed to. You're allowed up to four signs, not to exceed 64 square feet total. You've got two signs that come out to like 36 feet.
Yeah, two would be preferable.
So you want both sides, one in the front, one on the side, just where they are now.
Exactly the same.
Okay.
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the sign design. It has external illumination, so...
Second. Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you, Jim.
This is good.
And that's your contact information.
This is different.
Yep. Thank you.
Yep.
Yadin and Edith Mole?
Yes.
Hi.
Yeah, last time.
How do you spell the last name?
M-O-V?
M-O-R.
Oh, M-O-R.
Yeah, Dean and Edith.
Oh, that's a bar.
Yeah. Actually, we want to ask for a permit for an accessory apartment. And this is the application that you gave me. And then we filled it up. And there's some state.
The address here?
The address is 22 Sylvia Heights. Hello. We purchased the house probably almost 3 years ago.
In July 2013.
At the beginning of this year, we moved actually to this house. Part of the house in the first floor, it's only us who live in the house. We currently live in the house. Part of the house, on the original plans was a guest area in the first floor. And that's the area that we want to turn into an accessory apartment. We went through the bylaws. And,
you have plans for it and everything?
I'm sorry?
You have the plans that you want to do?
Yes. First you have the house.
Existing. Everything is existing.
Okay.
That's the front.
That's the house, okay.
Yeah, that's the plot plan here.
Where is this, the garage?
No, this is the garage. This is the area that we live in, and this is the accessory apartment.
That doesn't exist.
This is the front page of the front. This is the plot of the house. That's the front of the house. And the accessory apartment is this.
Oh, so this view
is the front.
Is it not showing this?
This is the view. The view is this.
Oh, there's two. Oh, okay. So this is the back.
It's in the back, exactly.
This is way in back of the house.
This is the view over here.
I have the original plans of the house that were submitted.
You're looking at this side of the garage. So it's going to be over in this corner over here.
It's in the back.
Yeah, I'll show you on the plot. It would be much easier. When you look at this, that's the front of the house. That's the garage. This is the three-door garage that you see here, and that's the porch that you see, the entrance, you know.
Kind of the back of the
apartment. The apartment is this part of the house, this part.
The apartment's here?
Yeah. That's the, yeah. And it's all in the first floor.
It has a separate entrance. This is...
If you look at it this way, that's the garage.
Yeah.
That's the view of the house. And that's the apartment. And the entrance to the apartment is from here.
Valerie Miller put the wrong date on it.
From here.
This is the front, right?
Right.
Exactly.
Oh. What's the next one?
Is the, actually, the apartment, as it was built, it's, this is how it looks.
Are you building this, or...
No, no, it's existing.
That's how we bought the house. Everything was existing. I don't have the original plans that were submitted, actually, to the township when the house was built about 20 years ago. But everything is existence. It's not that...
That was built 20 years ago with an accessory apartment?
With, the way they put it on the plan was a guest area. It was a guest area. That's the, actually, my, you know, what we wrote down, put together to support what we want.
Does the guest area currently have separate kitchen facilities?
It has a separate kitchen facility. We listed exactly here in the letter what's in there.
How many plans do you have?
I have actually three plans, you know, with...
Three sets.
How many?
You can have this one, Jim.
I need about four sets.
Four sets?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought that I need only two, but so I'm sorry. I'll be able to bring it to the office. I can make another copies or something.
You've got mailing labels on mailing labels?
Yes, sure, yeah.
Okay. That's the important thing.
Sorry, yeah.
Okay.
That's two for each.
Drop the, make three copies and put them in the planning board mailbox tomorrow in the town hall. In other words, when you go to file this with the town hall, there's a planning, right by the town clerk, there's a little mail slots.
Mm-hmm.
The planning board is right in there.
Okay.
Just put three copies in our mail slot of this mm-hmm. plan.
Okay.
Okay?
So I need three copies.
Three copies of this. Three more copies of this set.
And you're going to give one copy of all of this
to the town
clerk as well. So I guess you need four copies.
Okay.
You need four new copies, uh-huh. four extra copies.
You need one to make copies?
Maybe I can have one of them just in case.
Yeah.
I know
yeah,
exactly.
So, yeah.
Do you want also the letter that is attached to it?
With yes. Four copies of everything.
Four copies also.
Four copies of everything.
Do you want us to also add a picture of that side of the house where the apartment is?
No, that's plan fine. That you've got is good.
The plan is good.
The plan is good.
You need to see the original ones?
No. Those that you've got is fine.
Actually, we did a copy of what we have.
Yeah, I keep this one. I'll keep this one.
Okay, so we need four copies, three we need to put to the board and one to the, did you say the assessor?
No.
Town clerk.
City clerk.
Mm-hmm. City clerk. Okay. Okay.
Hey, tell me this, board. How could the building inspector issue an occupancy permit when no one has had a kitchen and everything in it as an accessory apartment?
You'd have to ask
there
him.
There was no accessory, it wasn't an accessory apartment, as much as I know.
Well, how long ago was this? When was it built?
The house about 3 years ago. Over 3 years.
It was built in 96.
96?
Right. Mm-hmm. We bought the house in
2013. Just like that.
Original owners were?
The previous owners?
Yeah.
The Hendersons.
No, you can keep it.
Oh, we can. Tony Barber and Henderson.
But they'll give you a new copy
before that.
So you can still be yourself.
Well, that's.
Okay, so the short answer, John, is we don't know. We don't know what was going on in 96.
Why, you were here. I wasn't.
We were here, but they wouldn't come to us.
Accessory apartments weren't allowed. There wasn't a bylaw for them in 96. Yes,
they didn't apply for accessory.
Yeah. And so if they went to the building inspector, we don't see plans for residential buildings. And we wouldn't know about it until right now.
But, I mean, could he have given a permit for that? Would that...
Not legally.
Oh. Not legally?
This is the way that it was built, and we see on the plans, they called it guest area.
They can call it what they want.
Yeah, I know, but that's...
We don't know.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know.
You guys are doing the right thing.
Yeah, we don't know what it was.
You're doing a good job. Keep smiling.
Okay.
Okay, and what's the next step now?
Show up on...
October 18th.
October 18th for the public hearing.
Okay.
And explain what you want to do to us.
Okay.
And the $6.25 we can pay right...
To the town clerk.
Okay. Tomorrow.
Okay.
When you drop off the extra copies.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thanks.
See you then.
Have a nice evening. Thanks.
Ed Ryan.
Yes, sir.
And company.
Well, I don't know about the company.
Good evening. After your review and consideration of an A&R plan on the courthouse property here off of Route 9, prior to coming here, we've been to the Zoning Board of Appeals and received two points of relief from them. First, a finding that what we proposed to do in separating the residence in a separate lot on West Street is not...
Give us a second to get this spread out.
Two mile lines. Got a couple of copies of the ZBA decision and the certification.
Okay.
Makes me look important with all these people.
Do you want a copy of the plan?
Sure.
We keep two copies of the plan.
We keep two paper copies. You get any extra paper copies and a Mylar back. Okay. So anyway, what are you doing here now?
We're separating the residence back on West Street out of the larger parcel that presently contains the courthouse and Pegasus. You may recall...
This parcel right here.
That's Kowalski's old house, right?
Okay. You may recall that we were required to buy that to satisfy some square footage for parking initially. When the calculation included the old school that was there plus the basement. As you know, that's since been replaced and put on a concrete slab. Reducing the square footage in the calculation for the required parking. We now can satisfy the parking even without the carving out the property on West Street. We have parking places in excess of the minimum required. We've been to the ZBA. We received from them a finding that what we propose to do is not more non-conforming or substantially more detrimental to the existing non-conforming. And we received a variance with respect to the rear lot line, which your code requires 40 foot, and the plan only shows 30 feet, and they granted a variance for that as well. The decision was filed with the town clerk, and have a copy of that for you. The 20 days has since expired without an appeal, and she has certified to that as well.
Do we ever get the signage problems?
Yes, we're happy to report.
That's all taken care of.
You knew that was coming.
We're happy to report.
We were ready to the south.
Yeah.
How many years did it take? Oh, not that long.
Well, let me ask a question on that sign. If you incorporated that sign with the other sign, you still would be under the square footage of the sign bylaw, wouldn't you?
Well, there were two freestanding signs. Was that?
There was one over here, and then the...
Right. We only allow one freestanding sign.
But if it was right one with two businesses on...
Same. Still 64 square feet.
Yeah. Were they both 64 square feet?
I don't know what the square footage was, but that was always a concern.
The building commission is happy, so we must have done it right.
Putting it right on the building.
Well, that guy said you gave him permission. And you had a different...
I tried to make keep you happy.
All right, so...
I guess we need a...
You want both Mylar signs or the same one?
You need one for your work.
Not Mylar.
Mylar.
We only need the paper copy. We need two paper copies, one for us and one for the Board of Assessors.
Okay.
I mean, we'll sign both. There's no big deal.
I need one to record. I don't know.
We need the plastic one to record, right?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, one plastic.
But so you can also make multiple
copies from
the signed Mylar, too. So.
Yeah. All right, so.
So you're making a certain amount of money then, signing it too.
Do you want to look here?
Yeah, you got it.
I just want to keep going.
This one's for me, because he's kind of saving.
This one's for George Boyle.
It is?
Yeah.
It's in small print. There it is.
Just a little knowledge game, Joe. Watch any little knowledge game?
Yeah, all of them. Unbelievable. The excitement is just amazing.
Yeah.
Walk this down the aisle.
Yeah.
Signed.
I think this is probably the new front you said creating.
Yes, that is correct.
You going to keep this?
Yep. These are all existing lot lines.
Are you going to keep this as house?
Frontage.
I'd like to sell it, actually.
So, 55 plus 91 plus 97.
Here are the two paper copies, guys.
Okay, who keeps these? You, Jim? These paper copies?
Yeah, I'll probably one.
What do you want to fold?
Let me one more signature.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
Joe sign that.
Yep.
We've got a couple of decisions of the ZBA.
Let's just get to it.
One more. I think this is the. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
We enough paper to be dangerous? Good.
You're free to go.
Yes. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
You're free to go on good behavior now.
A little by time.
Justin Killian? Killian. Let me rock.
Hello. So I'm just here for the signed mock-up that you guys requested last time. 251 Russell Street. There's a materials list and other specs on the side. And there's
okay.
Additional measurements on the second page as well.
What happened to the rock with the circle on it?
We're going to move it. That was the solution to the problem.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Move it off the site, move it out of the way?
Yeah, move it. It's 3,500 pounds, I think they calculated.
Wow, okay.
So that's going right in its place, that new sign.
Okay.
And it's externally illuminated?
Yep, solar. There's a spec sheet here for the...
Dimension? Oh, here we go.
6 by 8. Yeah.
Okay.
What do you mean?
No sign on a building?
No.
Okay.
The building big enough for what you're doing?
Yeah, it's working out well.
Good.
It's really good. Good.
So how many square feet is this sign?
48.
48?
Yep. Yeah, that's just the building, in case you guys...
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve sign design.
Second. Any discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously.
Great. Thank you. Yes. You want three, you said? Or does it doesn't matter?
No.
No, that's...
Well, I mean, they want to keep theirs.
Just copy.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
Okay. Good luck. Yep.
Thank you.
Nope, you're welcome.
For a souvenir, when I come to you, I'm going to bring...
Perfect.
Get some fitness.
John wants the stone. John wants the big rock in his truck.
Right.
You can have it.
Winter traction.
Piece of the rock.
Okay.
Just what I need. Put it in my boat.
Yeah, your anchor.
I needed that.
You won't drift with that.
Want to do the unofficial review of the small scale poll for Mr. Shardar Parmar? Shardar Parmar?
That's good. So, you guys, everybody already had a copy of this. So, this is. Another ground-mounted system built on a slitter rack. It's going to be 28 modules, all with microinverters, placed behind his house, utilities trench 10. I believe, like the last one, we're going to have, because of the topography, we're going to have concrete, which is going to require the deed requirement that he signs it.
Okay.
So you can't do it. You concrete what?
Concrete sonotubes.
Not allowed.
Not allowed?
Not allowed.
Not allowed at all.
Not allowed.
So what do you got to do?
Dig them in the dirt. Steel pipes. Steel posts in the ground.
No concrete whatsoever anymore?
Correct.
When did that happen?
We missed it on your last application.
Okay.
So we let it go.
So now there's no concrete whatsoever?
Correct. The only concrete allowed is under your, if you have a system.
Yep.
You can put it under your, if you put a... Like a switch gear, mm-hmm. Put it on the switch gear. Everything else is going to be no concrete.
Okay. All right.
So you're going to drive steel pipes in the ground or screws or something?
I don't know if we can. See, we got some ledge up there. So the only option the homeowner has is to probably not build. I'm not sure if he'll be able to. See, the problem with ledge is we don't know if we can drill it.
Yep.
What? Because you can drill it, and then when you get down to a certain depth, you can pile it in. But we have to check with engineering first. I'm just trying to make sure.
What's that on Chamorro Road?
No. Is it on Chamorro?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's not going up the wag plan, is it?
No.
Nope.
No.
I thought that only pertained to Agway.
No.
Someone mind telling me what does it matter if it's not Agline?
Because we don't want it's either going to be removed, we want it to be just pulled out of the ground and gone in concrete.
28.6.
If it's in a, what size sonotube is that?
I'm checking right now.
I mean, I pull fence posts out with the sonotube, everything one shot. When I take them out.
Yeah.
28.6.9, this applies to all systems, not just small scale, large scale as well. All land associated with solar energy system shall be natural vegetation. No system shall use impervious surfaces in its foundations, footings, or paths between solar panels. Exceptions are concrete slabs on grade to support electrical switchgear and enclosures.
Where did that bylaw come from? Who drew that up?
That was part of the plans, this...
But I want to...
Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, I agree 100% with that statement.
I know.
Well, we worked on it with them in great painful detail.
Adopted May 6, 2012.
Wait a minute.
4 years ago.
Bylaws to be changed and revised.
That's absolutely the truth.
But I want to know just the purpose of it, because I mean...
The purpose of it was that in case something is going to be with, when it comes time to remove it, there's no concrete slabs or anything else to make it that much more costly to remove. Just get rid of the panels, steel out of the ground.
But you can remove. Listen, and I've done this on different jobs. Four cement, hook up, and just pull everything right out.
And the other thing had to do with the drainage, too. Concrete slabs, you've got to have a...
It's below the grade, so it's got to go a drain.
So if we find that we can't drive this, what's our next step?
It's in the bylaw now. We have to abide by the bylaw. If you want to change it, you have to go to the town meeting.
So when would that be?
So it's not the end of the world.
Come back and let us know when you want to do it.
So why don't you find out and come back to the next meeting?
Yeah, the next meeting is what day?
2 weeks from tonight.
13th?
No.
6th of 20th.
20th.
Yep.
So come back on the 20th.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So what we'll do is... I'm going to make a motion to continue the administrative review.
Yeah. Okay, to the 20th.
Second.
Right.
Okay.
I still haven't got a good reason for my colleagues about sonotubes, because you can't put your teeth in, you can't remove
it. How big is the cement? Is it just a sonotube, or is it cement pad?
That's what he said.
No, just sonotubes.
How big of a sonotube?
How big is a sonotube?
They're 24 by... I want to say, it's got to be 6 feet.
So...
What diameter?
24 inches in diameter.
And how deep are they?
6 feet.
That's been the fairly standard.
Okay.
No, it's just something, to advise that we missed for the customer. So we'll see if we can drive it, and we'll be back on the 20th.
Right, okay.
So, John, to your point, we occasionally find there is something in the bylaw that doesn't work, and this may be one of those things, but we don't have authority to waive it. It has to go back to town meeting.
You were the one that put it to town meeting, and it's just like,
yep.
I look at things, if it's not really justified and it makes it easier for someone, I don't care who, but Pioneer Valley gives you all this humble jumble here. Things still can be changed.
They can be. By town meeting. We can take it up next spring.
Absolutely correct.
But
town meeting can do that. We had never done solar panels when this thing came through. It's like a lot of the things we're doing. It's uncharted territory. We aren't exactly sure what's going on. And so
when the bylaw...
So we take the conservative road when it comes to us.
But at the same token, it was voted by town meeting. Anyone who thought they saw a problem there had a chance to stand up and say something.
Well, I see a problem with it.
Okay.
Okay.
Right. And I'd like to see that addressed for our next town meeting.
So if we're doing the driven posts, do we still need the deed rider for removal upon... Because last thing was for concrete removal. So do we need the same deed rider if we're not doing concrete?
The others have not been putting it in for a deed rider.
No, we have not been voting it.
Okay. All right. So it's no concrete, no deed rider.
Right.
Right.
Gotcha. Okay, gentlemen. Thank you. Have a great night.
But if that was on a deed that they have to remove it, what's the difference then?
What do you mean?
They can walk away from it too.
But I mean, No, it's put on a...
Yeah, but the point is, that's what the bylaw says. We're in charge of administering the bylaw.
Don't get stuck on a bylaw, Bill. If the bylaws need to be revamped and changed as time goes on.
At this point, John, when we're in the permitting phase...
You get a stubborn...
Yeah, when we're in the permitting phase, we do get stuck on the bylaw. We have to follow the bylaws.
I understand.
That's what town meeting told us we had to do. So we could have asked them for something else. We didn't. This is what we asked them for.
Well, whatever we asked them, most likely they would pass anyway.
Oh, you know that's not quite true.
It is.
Mr. Larry.
Make this meeting accept.
I'll weigh in on this.
Okay, go ahead. Come real way in.
Which is, this is just not a PVPC thing. This is...
This guy.
It's exactly. That's state of the art. Nobody plants them in concrete. They're either screwed in...
Says who?
I work in Spencer. That's not Pioneer Valley.
You've got two strikes against you, right?
That's Central Mass. We did a 70-acre solar facility, which is really big. They did one that was even larger than that. I think we've done, since I was there in the last year and a half, probably five. None of them use concrete.
Are you trying to tell me like a 6-inch or 10-inch sound tube is tough to go?
I'm telling you...
This is 24-inch.
Yeah, I'm telling you...
Well, that can even...
I'm telling you that what best management practices for constructing these things are, they're either screwed in, or literally it's a 6 or 7 foot aluminum shaft with a screw on it that they're screwed in, or they're pile drived in, but they don't use concrete.
What, a situation like ledge or something, what do you have?
If he's going down 6 feet to put in a sonnet tube...
The screw is going to work the same.
Exactly.
Not through ledge.
He doesn't, but he's not going through...
He's not putting a sonnet tube through ledge.
Yeah, but he said it's 6 foot long.
He says it's 24 inches by 6 feet.
So if he's going into his ground 6 foot, whether it's concrete or a screw, it doesn't matter. It's going to hold. There's no load on these things.
No.
And the other thing you have is when you decommission the site, when you screw them in or pile drive them, you just pull them out. When you set them in concrete, you've now got these shafts with these 6 foot by 2 foot concrete chunk on the end of it. You have to get rid of it.
A 24 inch diameter by 6 foot long, even if it's in the ground 5 feet.
Yeah.
That's a lot of dirt to fill out.
That's correct. And it's a big chunk of concrete you've got to get rid of.
Yeah. So that's their problem.
But that's the problem. We want to make it so
if it's not necessary, and there are other alternatives, there's no reason to do it.
I got one eye, and I'm going to keep that close eye.
Okay. What do you got, Larry?
Okay. We got a few things. I emailed you. We got a few more chapters of the...
Close that eye sometime.
Wait a minute. Go to one of the bad ones.
Hey, I went to an eye doctor. They made me do that, right?
That's good. Now I'm going to.
Go to sleep.
I'm going to start with the definition sections. And so what I've done... 3, 1, 2, 3. For the definition section, and I went through, and all of these words are in your bylaw. So you've got like 11 pages of definitions. A lot of them are just standard definitions, of which you don't have, or you have them buried in sections of the bylaw, so I pulled them out and put them in all in one location. The dark is there are two different definitions of agriculture.
Is this dark stuff in the...
No, I highlighted that just to show you. You kind of have a choice which way you want to go. And I always suggest that when you're defining agriculture, you refer to the state definition of agriculture under 128.1A. It's also defined under, in fact, I think I even like it, the one that's under zoning. There's a definition for agriculture under zoning.
That's the first one?
No, that's actually...
The second one,
but there's another reference that should be going in there. And the only reason I like to use is our state law already has a definition. I think for consistency, you ought to use that.
Yeah.
Rather than forging out on your own, because eventually...
Somebody's going to come in.
Absolutely right.
Yep.
You've got to run into a conflict.
Yep.
The first definition is what we have now, you're saying?
I believe the first definition, I think, I got out of your bylaw.
Okay.
And the second one is what you want to change?
Yes. But again, I think we got to plug in the reference to MG 40A.
Because 40A has a section on it that talks about exempt, agriculturally exempt activities, and it gives a definition there.
48, that's chapter 128.
Yep.
What are you talking, 48?
Well, like I just said, John, we have to insert that as well.
Oh, you have to.
Yeah. And if you go to the last page, there are a whole bunch of definitions, and we talked about this as well. But these definitions are germane to specific sections of your bylaw, such as the Aquifer Protection District, signs, your adult entertainment uses. And so what we did is we're leaving those, because those apply to only those districts or the chapter, we're going to leave those where they are.
So you brought in some that we don't have in the bylaw, like childcare facility, childcare home.
Yeah.
I don't think we have. So this is...
You have those uses, but you don't have them defined.
Okay.
So because I went through and I did a word check, because there were some words that you don't have in your bylaw that I don't. Because if you're not in your bylaw, you don't need a definition for it. And the childcare facility and family childcare and large family is defined under the state law in terms of how they license those facilities. And you do in your bylaw in the table have, you know, them specified as individual for principal uses.
So farm stand, you've got it kind of confined to the months of June, July, and August.
You have them confined to the months of
we
June,
do.
July, and August. This is your current definition, but okay. Oddly enough, that's pretty much what the definition says.
Okay.
I will pull out for you. Bob Richard did a wonderful thing once where he took the section about the exemptions for agricultural uses and educational uses and the like, and it's like one sentence with like 700 words to it and, you know, 47 yeah. commas,
yeah.
And it's the worst drafted, worded law you've ever seen in your life. And I actually had to take it and try to bullet it so I could make sense of what it said. And he had done that as well, so I can give that to you as well. And that kind of shows you what are exempt and what are not exempt.
Why does this only go to August when people sell stuff on stands?
He's just saying.
Yeah, that's, in fact, I believe that's actually out of the state law.
This June, July, August out of state law?
I believe it is, for farm stand. I
so
believe it is.
Not, so this is not in our law?
It is currently in yours.
With those June, July, August?
Yes. Yeah, that's where that came from.
Okay.
That came from your bylaw.
Well, it's considered to sell stuff in a farm stand from about April through December.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, you sell asparagus and
it doesn't
May.
Mean you can't sell it. It's just when you're determining the 50%, those are the months that you're counting.
Oh, okay.
It's okay. I'm telling you.
Okay.
And I'm sure you've wrestled with that section of the law.
Okay.
It's a horribly worded thing. So what I can do is I'll pull out.
So during those 3 months, that's when you're going to have 50% or more.
That's correct.
Outside of those 3 months, it doesn't apply.
Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't factor into the 50%.
Okay. All
it's,
right. Okay.
It's,
that makes more sense.
So anyway, I will pull that out, what Bob put together, because I thought that was, first of all, it was very, very funny.
Fences. I remember many years ago when we were trying to come up with a good fence bylaw.
Yep.
A farmer's fence is usually right on the line versus a neighbor's fence. It's a little different.
It is. Fences are always tough.
No,
some towns,
not according to our bylaw, you don't
require that you offset the fence 3 feet.
Okay.
So that if you have to paint the other side of the fence, you can do it without getting on your neighbor's property.
Get the weeds.
The weeds.
Yeah.
The problem you have is if you put up your fence 3 feet away from the property line and the neighbor puts up his fence 3 feet from the property line, now you have 6 feet of no man's land between these two fences that are running parallel to each other along the property line that may or may not get mowed. Or may grow up. It's fences are tough.
So they're considered accessory structures. That means setback has to be different.
Yeah, I mean, typically, you would have a fence bylaw, and the fence bylaw would say...
Correct.
You can put the fence on the property line, you know, but we just recommend you offset it so you can get in there and maintain it, and the like. And typically, your fence is no more than 6 feet, except from the front setback to the front lot line, it drops down to 4 feet, so it doesn't obstruct traffic visibility as you're approaching the street.
Yep.
And it's no more than 4 feet along the front property line for the same purposes.
I think it can't be more than 4 or 5 feet, otherwise it's considered a...
Spike fence.
By Mass Building Code.
Six foot, you know?
There are a lot of myths about fences, like you have to put the nice side of your fence facing your neighbor's property.
No, that's not true.
That's not true. Same with the spite fence. I think it's 6 feet.
That's what I thought the building inspector told me.
You did have a discussion over your property. What was the final resolution with that?
Well, if you get the neighbor to agree that it's okay.
Six feet?
But if the neighbors agree...
You could put a 10-foot if the neighbors agree.
No problem.
All they could do is agree and write that you can put up such and such a fence.
And there are some land uses where you want a taller than a 6-foot fence.
Right.
Just for security purposes.
Mm-hmm.
Which I'll mention, by the way, you folks are infamous.
So fences are considered...
You're infamous.
Oh.
We had a pre-submission meeting for a medical marijuana facility this morning in Spencer. And when they heard that I was from Western Mass, and in fact I had assisted your board, they said, oh, really? Aren't they the guys with the the mosque?
Yeah.
So the industry is on to you.
Well, why is that really, why are you laughing at that? Why is that funny?
Well, we used to be known as the square.
Yeah, the Hadley Square, which I still...
We've set a lot of precedents in zoning.
Yep.
We were the first one with the TDR bylaw.
Yep, you were. And you're about the only one that has one that actually works.
Yes.
Yeah.
Regarding your John had a question on the farm stand, back to the farm stand.
Yeah.
He said, should we put words in there that it's only during a month, during the rest of the year, it doesn't have to be 50%?
What I'm going to do is pull out the breakdown of the state law under, I think it's just Section 3 of 40A, that defines what a farm stand is and what exempts the farm stand as a farm stand.
So there's somebody from the state going around and checking the sources of the vegetables being sold in your stand?
It's one of those things that if somebody complains, you've got something to go in to do. And again, this only applies to those that are exempt. If you want to have a farm stand that's not agriculturally exempt, and you want to treat it as a principal use in your table of uses, you could do that.
So that's what we ran into with the North Hadley Sugar Shack, because it's in a limited business district. It doesn't rely on the agricultural exemption. It's there as a, it's a business use in a business district.
Yeah. Part of it is agricultural exempt, part of it is not.
Yeah. Right. You know, I remember you had something, you know, somebody was selling ice cream. I think it was the one on...
They run into that...
That was years ago.
Years ago.
Yes, they're correct.
Yes, and that would finally determine that it was okay because it was not the principal use of the farm stand. It was okay to sell ice cream.
There you go.
But by then, he'd already closed it.
But the building's still there.
Yes.
Yeah.
So John and Mike, when we started this process of modernizing the bylaw, that was back in the days when John Devine and Lisa Sanderson were on the board, and we've been chipping away at it ever since. And this is not the first time we have found something that doesn't make a lot of sense. And remember, this bylaw got started, I think my uncle worked on it in 1960. This bylaw got started in 1960. It has been amended by people with the best of intentions, but sometimes not the most attention to detail for 60 years, almost.
You have to go back periodically and overhaul it.
Yep.
Because what you have is a bylaw, and when you read it, you can see how it was put together chronologically. Where something comes up and they add a section to it, and they add a section to it, and they add a section to it. And sometimes you don't necessarily go back to a prior section that it affects because you didn't realize it at the time.
And sometimes
it's like when you put all of the uses.
Yep.
In a table.
That was exactly.
And we're looking at it, and individually, you'd never see it.
Right.
You put it at a table, it's like, and Johnny was the first one, who's this? We're all. And I says, adopt it as it says. And then we go back and make changes. If we try to make the changes and make it altered, we would go nuts.
Yeah, that's true.
Now that we see it in one place.
Yep.
You know, what Bill's saying.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Over time, it has evolved, but it's never gone back to correct the originals or make the originals more correct.
Yeah.
And you've got some very strange words in there.
Yeah. And you also sort of have to go back and take a look at it when you have a turnover of the board and you lose that institutional memory mm-hmm. of why that was adopted and how you administered it. And somebody green comes on and they can't make heads or tails on it.
Yeah.
So question, accessory structures for a fence.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of structure is that?
Accessory structure for a fence.
Is accessory structures in our bylaw or is that out of the state law under the fence?
Under fence.
Talking fence, we're talking the definition of a fence?
Fence yes. are considered accessory yeah. structures.
Is that our wording or is that in the state law?
I will double check on that. I don't think you have a definition for fence.
Okay, we do not.
We have definitions.
Yeah, but I mean, my question is why is a fence called a structure? What is the definition of
it? Well, it's a structure. You need a building permit for it. It's as much
What's
as.
What's the true definition of a structure? Is it a building or what is it?
A structure is not necessarily a dwelling. A structure basically, well, do we find a structure?
There is a definition
yeah, I think
of
we
a structure.
Define a structure. It usually has, what, four sides?
Just a combination of materials assembled at a fixed location to give support or shelter.
There you go.
Yeah, that's not a shelter.
Building, framework, retaining wall, tent, reviewing stand, platform, bin, fence, sign, flagpole, mast for radio antenna, or the like. The word structure will be construed where the context allows as though followed by the words or parts, part or parts thereof.
I mean, it is a structure.
Right
there are many things that are structures. Now, you know, listen to what the fence pole looks like.
Yeah, we had
it's not just a building.
Swimming pool.
A swimming pool is
yep. It's a structure.
Yep.
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 But what that is an in-ground pool a structure? An in-ground pool is a structure. Is it an above-ground pool a structure? That's been debated a lot.
It will be debated a lot because you probably need a permit for the in-ground.
Yes.
You might not necessarily need a permit for the above-ground.
Correct, unless you put a deck or something.
That's right, with it.
Mm-hmm. And then it gets into the question of what requires a setback.
Yes.
Not every structure.
A fence, I mean a pole above ground, requires by the insurance a 4-foot fence right around the donut.
An in-ground requires that.
Not an above ground.
An above ground just requires the ladder has to be able to be child-proofed.
Withdrawn or something, yeah.
Yeah, but if that pole is under 4 foot, isn't it? Is the 4 foot?
I'm not sure how
yeah.
exactly all the.
I'm not an expert on that, so I've weighed in as far as I could.
I thought you knew everything.
That guy.
Hey, Randall.
I just don't mind getting rid of my pole. I can see a big
yeah, Bill's question and
hole now, right?
Yeah.
Now.
Mine as well. Don't we have accessory
hole right now?
Like a accessory building setback in the backyard has to be 15 feet.
Usually you do.
So
usually your building is like 25 feet, 50 feet. Sometimes the accessory building is area equal to its height.
So that's what you're getting at, Bill? So does that fence mean the same thing as an accessory?
Well, again, this is why it's a really good idea to have a fence section where you can...
Boy, that's a toughie. I mean, I remember trying that many years ago again, and because a farm fence is a different animal from a neighborhood fence.
That's true. But if you don't have it, then that's a problem you run into.
That's next year's assignment.
Yes.
So definitions need a little more.
Yep.
More substantiated.
Take a look at it. Additional information I'll get you on that.
From a historical point of view, my understanding, our bylaws were written by Ted Bacon, dean at Amherst College, who was on the planning board at Amherst, and he wrote up a checklist.
Yeah.
The frontage will be 100 feet, 125 feet, 175 feet. check the one of the above. So if you look at the, you know, the small booklet that we have, Hatfield, Hadley, they are all the same printer, all, they were all the same wording, but just the different checkbox for...
I thought Eddie Padauk had a lot to do with the...
No, he claims he did, and he did not.
Were you on the board back then?
I was on the board when...
Yeah, you're old enough, you've been doing this all the time.
Okay.
Anyway, next one.
Okay.
Lot of institutional knowledge.
Next I'm going to hand out, we updated the transportation section, of which I only have three copies. I printed up. Who wants a copy?
That's all right.
Okay, so I will hand out three, and you can find over.
You can look at them.
I have my own.
But you have your own.
We took out the two-lane road proposal for Route 9 through the center of town.
Okay.
Chapter with transportation.
And we also met with Gary Rue, our transportation section, and incorporated a lot of information that we had gotten from the state relative to a lot of the work that they're doing.
Good move.
We get a share. Times are getting tough over there.
Yeah, so...
Don't ask for a raise, no, time you come in here, you come in here.
I know.
Just, you know what?
Well, you know what, I had a choice. I could either print up three color copies or five black and white.
What are we, back in zero or what?
Here.
Larry.
Well, sir.
But you do, I did email that to you, so you do have a digital version of that. I also have the land use chapter. And I do have five copies of that.
I have my own copy.
Oh, these, I was counting on you for the other one.
Are we going to talk about which of these are good?
We can if you want. Want to talk about the transportation before we move on? Okay, let's do that.
So is the transportation one that you sent emailed different than the one you just passed out?
No, the one I most recently sent you. I sent you the revised, updated version of it. So that is, in fact, the same.
Okay. And this does not completely incorporate the latest thinking from MassDOT?
It's supposed to.
Okay.
It's supposed to have. And I tell you, that section of Route 9 is... As we're working on the different chapters with the land use and that kind of development of the light, it's just a muddle. Because when you talk to MassDOT, and they're correct, you know, their intent and their concern is moving that traffic through during the peak hours fast. You know, you have really, really high volumes, you know, slowing it down, you know, with bump outs or raised sidewalks or something for traffic calming. Doesn't make sense. It makes sense in terms of developing it as a village center and a people-oriented, you know, commercial district and the like, but in terms of how it actually functions and its purpose, which is Route 9, which is a major transportation, you know, route for employment base and commuters, what Mass DOT is really interested in, and I can't say that they're wrong, is just moving high volumes of people through that section. Now, there are ways of doing that other than widening the road for more cars. You know, there's, you know, getting people to carpool and getting more people in the buses and things like that.
Good try. Yeah.
But there's always this phenomena that you throw in an extra lane, and in 2 years, it's going to be filled up.
Bigger parking. No, it's the same thing on the Damon Road section. Oh. That is the clicks of the whole Route 9 corridor.
Yeah.
The jam.
Well, the light they put in it.
Oh, that's
right. Does feel dry.
If they don't put a clover leaf, or they're going to put, what do they say?
Yeah, I think they're looking at doing a roundabout there.
Yeah, in 2020.
That will.
I question that just because of the volumes that they're talking about. The roundabout works terrific at Look Park.
Right.
I think it's going to work great on Route 9 down by the bowling alley.
Right.
I think that's perfect for down there.
But it's going to look
for the volume of traffic that you're going to have going through that.
Look at Damon Road now.
You need a.
Yeah, and they were talking about doing two lanes.
Well, go back to Memorial Drive in Chicopee.
Yeah.
There used to be two roundabouts there.
Yeah.
I remember as a kid, I was 16, 17, the roundabout where the KMC is now, and the roundabout further up. Those were true roundabouts.
That's correct.
But they were such traffic nightmares. Now what are they? Straight through in a roundabout.
Yep. They are. I mean, the double roundabout by Atkins works great.
Yeah.
But it has not really high traffic volumes. The roundabout at Look Park works great. Same reason.
You know, the best thing I ever seen is when you hitting 787 in New York over to Hudson.
Yeah.
The clover leaf, it just goes.
Yeah.
Fast volume and disappear. But a roundabout is not fast volume.
Well, I'm not a traffic expert.
Yeah.
I know.
It's a tough call, but certainly that's our blessing, that's our curse.
It's true. I mean, because right now, what the state's looking at is they've got traffic backing up, you know, traffic coming off the Northampton exit onto the bridge, backing up under Route 91.
Yeah.
It's a real problem.
And I know what the state thinks. They want to make bicycle lanes. I think that's suicide to allow a bicycle lane on Route 9.
Especially where you have the bike trail.
Exactly correct.
Different departments.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's true.
Even the bike lane, I mean, I see this picture of a bike lane. Yeah. This is the old 5 and 10. Nobody goes on that road anymore. And no bicycles, no cars. But Route 47 is a tight road in some sections.
Okay, so quick going over this thing. What are the quick review of the transportation network, Larry?
Yeah, they updated more of the data. When we go to the implementation, here we go. I'm going to start on page 9. And these are the road improvements and goals. And these really have not changed from what the original version was.
They were talking when we were in Bill, at that DOT meeting, that they want to take the 4-lane and they're favoring the 3-lane, right?
Yes. That is what they are favoring at this point.
They don't want the suicide lane?
No, they want that.
They want the suicide
lane. Yeah.
That's usually what you go to next. And that works out great for a while, and then when the volumes increase, and call it suicide lane for a reason.
That's actually better than a 4-lane.
It can be.
Yeah.
It actually can be, especially if you don't have the width to put the 4 lanes in.
Are you talking about the center turning lane?
Yeah, the center turning lane, yeah. But you're both coming in, and you're both...
So you both have a head-on collision?
Well...
Well, that.
Who you play chicken?
That's if you're going fast.
Yeah, that's exactly.
You're a teenager all over again, John.
Exactly.
The 3 lanes in orange. Remember that stretch?
Yes.
That was suicide.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I mean, they do work with it. There's a, I can't remember the in Ware, the road that heads down to Palmer, yeah. On their commercial strip. They have one that I think works very, very well. But people know it, and people know how to use it, and so it does function. It does function very well.
I look at this, everything they do is just a trial and error. They can draw pictures on a paper, but then it doesn't work.
There is a lot to that. I know that, they put some new light in an Industrial Drive on Damon Road.
Yeah.
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 And that, of course, was timed for the bullet train that came through twice a day.
At 10 o'clock, 3 o'clock,
2:30
nobody
or something.
Uses it.
But for the whole, for those two runs, basically, they had this. And the idea was they didn't want traffic backed up from the King Street light over the track, so they wanted it to drain through. Sure, and so that's why they stop.
So they go from Industrial Drive all the way back to Route 9.
But they've changed it, to their credit. They have now made westbound traffic on Damon Road 2 lanes. Going straight. It used to be 2 lanes, but one was a left-hand turn onto Industrial Drive. Those are now both straight through.
No, aren't they?
Or left-hand. And when you get to the King Street intersection,
there's one left.
It's 2 lanes now all the way to that intersection. Because remember, it used to go back down to 1 lane. So it's now 2 lane going straight. The far left lane is a right-hand turn onto 91 northbound or Big Y Shopping Plaza, or straight through. The middle lane is straight through, and the left lane is as it is now, left-hand turn heading south on King Street. So now you have two lanes potentially going through that intersection, then coming down to one lane as you're approaching the traffic light at the top of the hill past D'Angelo's in that place.
Yeah, Weber and Grinnell there.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Which is, I think, a big improvement. But I think they recognized there was a problem with the original design, and you have to go back and tweak it.
So, is there more you want to talk about on the transportation?
Not the transportation, because again, the recommendations really did not change from the first time. Here's the land use section, and I was reading this, one, two, I gave Joe his already. So here are the four of those. And we can talk about the recommendations, but I was reading through this over the weekend. I noticed that when it was updated, they didn't update the questions, the community survey questions. So I'm going to ignore those, but I think what I do want to do is probably just go to where the recommendations are. We'll start on goals, page 11.
Yeah, my version must have come out of a larger, because mine starts on page 13.
Oh, I renumbered that.
Okay.
13 is really number one now.
Okay.
I did that. Sorry.
Okay.
All right. I will also point out that there's a really interesting page, I think, which is on page 6, where it lists all the land uses, the land use changes over the years, the percentage change.
What jumps out at you?
Well, here's the problem with this. Well, what jumps out at me is, you know, the from 97 to 05, the 34% loss of cropland, or the 60% increase in pasture land.
But here's
the problem.
That's one and the same thing.
Here's also what the problem is, which is from the they do these. This is called Mass McConnell. The state does it. They do an aerial flyover of all the communities, and then they do an assessment of the land uses, a visual of it, to determine what land uses are what. And this last flyover, they changed the way they did it.
Maybe they're flying upside down.
Well, a couple of things. They have much, much better cameras this time. So the resolution they had to really see what was going on the ground was much better, so it was much more accurate. They also did such a thing as it used to be. If you had a single-family home in 10 acres of woods, they would call that 10 acres of single-family home. Now what they're doing is saying, you know, this acreage is single-family home and the woods is woods. Type thing. They also distinguish in terms of wetlands. They have wetland forest, and that used to be under forest or perhaps wetland, and so they subdivided it. So it's a little funky trying to compare it and get a good comparison. So we just raise caution that some of those numbers are going to really look out of whack. And the next time they do a flyover, it'll be much more of the information will be much more valuable.
So as you can see, I have a lot of editorial notes to scan and send to you.
Yeah.
So Larry,
so do I.
You're
so
saying
it was like I think he left out one of your you have two. You have a limited business district and a low business district or something
local
like that.
Business.
Local, there you go.
Yeah.
And I think he left off one of those, yes.
So,
and I think he also, at one point, I think, I think he talked about your phased growth bylaw.
Yeah.
Which is no longer
dead letter.
Yeah, exactly.
And one of the recommendations was that to make use of the agricultural preservation, and I hauled out a Rick Chandler, when he worked for Department of Ag Resources, put me in touch with Michael Gold, who is their statistician, I guess.
Yeah.
So this was in 2012. Hadley, at that point, had 2,574 acres in APR, which put us first in the state in area in acres protected.
Yep.
And this whole section was virtually mute as to APR. and the volume of protected farmland. It makes it sound like every acre of farmland is at risk.
There's another chapter on agricultural lands and open space resources, so that's where that's going to kind of show up. But that's true.
It should be in here. They should.
Well, you know, your farmland could be in three different places. It could be in land use. It could be an open space. If for some reason they have a special chapter on natural resources and ag land. And I agree with
you. It needs a lot more cross-referencing then, because this paints a picture of our frittering away our ag land when we are doing no such thing.
Yeah, and
the amazing thing is pasture land has increased dramatically. I don't see that happening at all.
Pasture land, if anything, is decreasing,
anyway. Yeah, nobody puts their cows out the pasture anymore.
You know, again, the statistics on that chart, I can't speak to, but that comes from the state. But and again, it's good for general land use planning tools. Just don't get really wrapped up in it.
In the cropland, it's almost cut in half. I don't see that happening either.
Yeah.
I found a lot of the text here to be kind of, the sky is falling, the sky is falling.
Oops. Residential building lots, less than a quarter of an acre, you got a 200% increase.
Yep.
Is that what?
I'm on page six.
It's on page six, yep. A 200% increase, the quarter acre.
Yep.
Because
it went from zero to two. To 2 acres.
Right, in 2005, where were the quarter acre building lots approved?
The apartments?
No.
But it's only 2 acres. I mean,
I know.
That's a postage stamp. In terms of the size of the town.
It's just that quarter-acre building lots are no longer allowed by right, so that might have been a variance.
What it could have been if they didn't pick it up in the prior flyovers, and this time they did. Maybe that was always 2 acres. You had 2 acres of quarter-acre building lots. Maybe go back to 1920.
Yes, in 1971 they show none, and that the residential district existed, and that was roughly so.
But see, that's why don't get wrapped up in that.
Okay.
So if these numbers are way off, why are they in here?
Well, you can take them off if you want to.
No, I mean if they're. What are they?
I think when you go from 71 to 97, those are pretty much consistent. Okay, where you get the real odd thing. Oh, I have the same one with that same thing.
I'd probably send it to you.
No, I actually, probably two years after this, I did the same thing.
Okay.
Except I got it for the whole.
You make a good point, because the pasture land, there's a huge difference between.
Yeah,
good point.
Yeah, so where you lost it on one, you gained it on the other, and there probably was really no change. It's just they classified it differently.
Yeah.
I mean, typically, and I'll make sure it gets in, we put an explanation in here that explains what the value of this is, and it points out the anomaly for this last comparison. Okay.
Where's mining? Gravel banks?
Yeah.
Of which there is one in town, and has been for decades.
There used to be two.
B&M
used to have one. Yeah, that's one of them. Levinsky's. Actually,
there were three then.
So I was got three. Levinsky's.
Hip had one.
And B&M.
Three.
Even though that old gravel bank may no longer be used, if it still shows up looking like a gravel bank, what they're going to count.
Then the town had one on Bay Road. They used to remember that, the old sand pit?
Oh, yeah.
That was an old one.
Yeah, that's right. So do you want to go through the goals starting on page 11?
Yeah.
Okay. The first goal is to maintain Hadley's rural appearance and small town feel.
That was overwhelmingly number one.
It always is.
Always, okay.
It always will be.
Yep, okay. And we want to make...
Even in a town that doesn't have a rural, small-town appearance, that'll be number one.
Okay, all right, so how do we do it? How can we encourage that?
I think you just keep...
Focus new development.
Yeah, focus new development in sections of town that have the infrastructure and environmental conditions to accommodate growth and limit development in rural and environmental sensitive areas. And what that basically is saying, promote higher densities on those areas that have public sewer and public water that can support a higher density, and go for lower densities in the outlying areas where you have onsite systems to service it.
Limit new commercial development to Route 9.
Yep, and other identified areas while prohibiting new commercial development on Bay Road, North and South Maple Streets, and other agricultural residential sensitive areas. So sort of continue to do what you're doing,
yep,
you know, with Route 9. I know we had this conversation with the economic development section, which was as Route 9 is reaching its build-out and the saturation point, if you still want your commercial tax base to expand, which you probably do, and, you know, you're in a really good position in this town where you have such a big commercial base that it really helps underwrite the tax rate for the residential population in town.
And the agricultural.
And the agricultural, yeah. Yeah, that, yes, exactly. So your choice is basically either to expand the footprint of your commercial districts and eat up, you know, make them bigger, or increase the densities in your commercial districts and have them get more dense and build them up to additional stories. One of the things we had talked about was allowing for them to go through the additional stories or additional density, but have it trigger the TDR for that. So if they are going to go higher or go more dense, that's great, but let's use that to contribute towards, again, building up the kitty for your TDR to preserve more farmland that you're doing such a great job on.
Well, I see on Route 9 that they're starting to buy houses, knock down two houses, and build up business development in there.
That started 40 years ago?
Yeah.
Well, a lot of them are knocking down their
buildings. Absolutely. Well, that's what happens, John. I mean, originally the thought or the hope is on these commercial strips, and it happened here, and it happened on Memorial Drive, and it happened in West Springfield, it happened in Chicopee. That's happening in Westfield right now. It happened on Route 20, which is you're hoping that you can allow your commercial enclaves to develop here in a nice, you know, a node, and maybe have a node here. But the problem you have is, as these two commercial enclaves, or UMass for that matter, generate more and more traffic, that still creates increased traffic flows on the land in between the two. And what you ended up with on Route 9 was suddenly became a very, it was no longer a residential street.
Well, okay.
For the traffic flows. And people didn't want to live there anymore because you don't like to have to wait 5 minutes to get out of your driveway during rush hour.
Well, I have to wait 5 minutes to get out of my street on Side Street.
Yep.
But
yep.
You take the colleges out of here, we don't have no traffic problem.
Well, okay, I put that down.
Well, neither would we have Route 9.
It is true, but...
The colleges should start doing something like freshmen not having cars.
Yep.
But they depend on their parking fees, so that's what they want.
But what you find, and you know, I watched Route 9. I mean, I remember Route 9 when there was nothing, and I remember when the little stuff started going in on the Amherst Town Line with the movie theater and all that stuff. But what you saw was, and Route 9, when I first moved to the area, was a residential street. My wife's aunt lived right on Route 9,
right,
and had a little farm stand. And it was a residential street. It was two-lane and the like.
Yeah.
But as UMass grew, and as your commercial nodes grew, and the traffic flows increased, it became not a desirable place to want to live. And so a lot of the people that were living there over time, a couple of things happened. You know, they would sell out and three or four homes would be bought up by a commercial use, and they would level the houses and put a commercial use in. But what you also found was those existing homes that were still there turned into rental housing. And that's predominantly, I think, what you have there. Residential properties you now have on Route 9, I think, are predominantly rentals as opposed to owner-occupied. You still do have some owner-occupied. They're really, really nice. But a lot of the houses that I remember that were really, really nice aren't really, really nice.
Right.
And you always know that twice a year, you're going to see mattresses piled out in front of them.
Mattress sale.
You know, as you get the turnover in the student population. That's what you get. But that's kind of the reverse gentrification that you have on roads like Route 9. And eventually those homes that are rentals will be bought for commercial use because Route 9 is not a residential street.
What I really think is the retail business is getting easier. It's getting tougher, you know, because of the online shopping.
That's very true.
I think really this board needs to take some action about this to make it easier, whether it's 3 stories, 4 stories. So motels, they get motel tax, restaurant, they get meals tax.
Mm-hmm.
The town really benefits out of that financially.
You just because of the population base you have and the population you have that surrounds you and the population that uses that road, those Route 9 properties are going to be valuable for certain commercial uses.
Mm-hmm.
You are correct in that, you know, they may not be retail. Because that whole environment has changed drastically. And when we talked about the economic development chapter about a month or so ago, that was one of the things that we talked about.
Was it
Route 9? Route 9, especially when you get into the Amherst, is very heavily retail-oriented.
Yeah. When we had the rock climbing place, you can't buy that online.
Nope.
They got a new go-kart place in the mall there. That's not online.
Yep.
And a place like, look at Texas Roadhouse. That place is packed solid all the time.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to be ending up with uses that are not dependent on online. You know, you can't get a physical checkup online. You got to go to the doctors for that.
But I, you know, you, my feeling is
maybe not.
Now.
Exactly. That's changing too, isn't it?
This board is I feel is going to be more business friendly. And allowing them to do certain things that they're not allowed now,
yeah,
to try to enhance them and keep them here and keep that tax base strong.
Yeah, you know, everything's a balancing act.
Well,
and you want to do that, but you don't want to do it in such a manner that it comes out crappy.
Right.
And it is a balancing act because there was a lot of resistance to, for example, Lowe's development.
Yep.
That brought out a lot of people out of the woodwork, and
yep,
that told us to put a damper on business, not to encourage it.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a lot of petitions that came against what the planning board wanted. So
yeah,
there's a certain group of people that don't want to see any more,
yeah,
business,
well,
development.
For instance,
and our town is changing.
Between the Home Depot and there, that's really saturated right to the...
And that's sort of the point. You really have almost reached build out there.
Right. But something else could work there.
But once again, we have seen change. Remember the dead mall? We changed,
yep,
it to industrial because it was nothing was happening. It was a dead mall.
Yep.
So,
well,
then there's certainly you look at.
And now the mall that.
Steiger's.
That mall, now that's sort of the dead mall.
Yeah. Yeah. JCPenney, yep. Steiger.
Look at that, the old mall came in, they're all gung-ho to redo all those buildings. All of a sudden, everything stopped. What happened there?
Yeah.
What, the Mountain Farmers Mall?
Right.
They want to take down Burger King and
everything.
The old First National.
So they're waiting for tenants.
Yeah.
Everything's just standing there.
Yeah, they got their permits, and now they're just going to wait.
Route 9 and Haven reminds me a lot of Memorial Drive in West Springfield, which is, you know, it's a very active commercial area,
yep,
but it's mostly one-story buildings on it. If you take a look at Route 9, you do have some, you know, taller ones, but for the most part, they're one-story buildings.
Do those cities and towns have industrial development committees or something like that to,
yeah,
try to promote?
Yep.
Right. So that probably helps their communities.
You know, you have all the same communities competing for the same...
Exactly right.
The same, you know, business. Or they cannibalize each other.
So I think the density killer is going to be elevators and escalators.
Yeah.
Because everything has to be ADA compliant now. Putting a second story on, you know, look at the trouble Hampshire Mall got into because their offices weren't handicapped accessible.
Yep.
That's going to be the big limitation to doing, if we, I would have no problem saying, yeah, let's have a two-story, let's zone.
It's more cost-effective to go three and four stories than it is two stories.
A two-story building is expensive because of the elevator. Once you go the extra story, the elevator.
It makes much more sense.
Do not get greatly more expensive.
Yeah, you're correct.
It's the hardware for the elevator itself.
But the land situation, they got no other choice, is to go up.
Yeah.
Well, certain products here are never going to go up. You're not going to go up with McDonald's. You're not going to go up with Starbucks. You're not going to go up with all the eating places.
Well, there are plenty of communities where McDonald's is the first floor, and you've got something on the second floor, and then you've got apartments on the third floor. On your commercial strips, you're absolutely right. But, you know, they do have McDonald's in
Manhattan, Boston,
Springfield. They do have them in multi-use buildings, mixed-use buildings.
Well, as long as our two neighbors to the east and to the west continue to turn down businesses, we're going to be accepting them.
Yeah. But what you want to do is you want to accept them on Route 9.
Correct.
You know, you don't want it to...
Well, you know, development used to follow rivers, then it followed railroads, now it follows sewer lines. And
that's true.
Unless you put a sewer line in, you're not going to get a lot of big development.
Yeah.
And we have a handle on that. Okay, continue. I'm sorry. We digress.
Fine. That's fine. So anyway, goal one is to work on retaining the rural appearance and small town feel. Key strategies for rural character on page 13.
Well,
strengthen and update the floodplain regulations. I think we just did that.
Yeah. That was my comment.
Yeah. Creative development to control A&R, approval not required, residential sprawl. You know, until the state adopts...
That's a state issue.
Yeah, until the state adopts, you know, if they ever do, you know, their new zoning reform.
What happened to the zoning reform? Did it die?
Died.
It died. But it's coming back.
It's coming back every
actually,
year.
Actually, it got... it's true.
Or the 10th.
The last time it actually, I think it got through the Senate. It came out of committee on the Senate. Because it always falls in the House. In fact, we've got a conference call coming up with the Smart Growth Alliance to talk about the strategy for getting it resubmitted again. And it's funny, every time it gets resubmitted, it does get further. They had a whole slew of state senators who signed on to it and sponsored it.
Although all of the affordable housing lard that they added to it,
yeah, I know,
may make sense in metropolitan Boston, but that was just not going to be helpful here.
And you know, and there are our planners that I work with in this part of the state who opposed it just because of the by right multifamily use provision. They're not opposed to multifamily; they're just opposed to being by right. You know, they want to have some kind of control where it goes.
Yeah, right here, commercial / multifamily residential district.
Yeah,
that one did pop.
So you know, the ones control the commercial sprawl along Route 9. But rather than continuing to rely on single business zoning district along the full length of Route 9, Hadley should divide the corridor into districts of varying intensities, including the historic village district. One of the things, and you do have design guidelines already that we've worked on, but one of the things that's going to be coming out of this and came out of the economic development portion was to, for the village center, don't do it as an overlay district, do it as the underlying district. If you really want, if it's such a great idea and the design guidelines are so good, the problem you have by making it an overlay district is it's optional. And so you could go in and do a terrific project as the overlay district, the village center, and it'll be slam bang. Joe owns a piece of land next door. Joe's going to do what's permitted in the underlying district. That's going to detract from what you've just done on your project in the overlay district.
Our overlay district does impose design guidelines.
Yes.
not optional ones, mandatory, like square footage, floor area, peak roof design.
But the idea would be get rid of the underlying district and just have it be the Village Center district. And I think one of the things we have to look at is, and I don't want to say give up on Route 9, because it is what it is, but concentrate on Route 9 back. And what you ought to be concentrating on Route 9 is just getting some really good, safe pedestrian crossings, regularly spaced.
But the state doesn't want to put lights all the way through to slow the traffic up either.
Yeah, that's true. That's the...
They want that traffic moving.
That's the trade-off.
And it's their road.
It is their road. And they have, they've got a tough call. There's no real good, easy answer. There's no quick fix. There's nothing that's going to solve every problem without creating another one.
Imagine all the complaints they get all the time?
Yep.
Right.
Okay, minimize the sprawl along Route 47. And here's where he just talks about limited business, and we have the other district too.
I think we've just done a pretty good job of correcting that one.
Okay.
Between the limited business and local business.
Yeah. What you just have to be cognizant of is, creep. Little by little.
Well, it
lot
does,
by lot.
It does contemplate that. That is actually part of the strategy, that we want to have a place where the startup costs are not as great.
Yep.
So that theoretically, most of the businesses along there, apart from the spice company, most of the businesses along there are Hadley people
who
have built their own buildings there.
Yeah.
And
but you can develop incubator space, and I'm all for startups because they need places like that. You just can't start off with a business.
But
a lot of them start off small, home occupations.
The problem over on Route 47, most of the land is all under APR. So there's a handful of lots that are really available there. And
well, we can take a look at that and see if that's
probably the rest of it's all
the
aquifer recharge area.
Yeah, that is one of the things that is missing in this view of it.
Yeah.
If you take Route 47, you apply the Rivers Act.
Yep.
That knocks out a lot of the east
or
west side of the road.
Yep.
And you do APR. You did a development constraints map for us that showed slope, wetlands, APR, and other development constraints.
Yep.
And that, I think, should be in here because that that really advises this. There's not that much buildable land along Route 47. I'm just thinking of it on the north side. There is, you're absolutely right, John. Most of the fields that you can see up to the left and to the right as you go up 47, north of the center of town.
South isn't too much different.
Between the traffic lights and the Sunderland town line, most of the open fields you see on either side of the road are already in APR. And so that adds to the limitation.
You got the APR, you got the overlay on the aquifer recharge.
Well, the aquifer is not really hindering it that much.
Well, it still disallows certain types of businesses. So
my opinion is the businesses that it disallows, I'm not sure I'd want in town anyway.
Yeah. Okay, page 15, goal number 2. Enhance the town center.
Oh, the billboards. I didn't know who we...
Billboards. Yeah, what about the billboards?
Billboard removal and sign control.
They could be phased out.
Do you have billboards?
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got 3, I think.
Okay, there's one
by Rockies, one by the...
I think they can be phased out.
Yeah,
one by Route 9 by the bridge. One at Rockies.
No, one at the Shell station.
Oh, you're right. Now that I think of it, Florence Savings Bank.
Yeah.
I've got one by the vet.
Orange Saving.
You know, I drive by those so often.
By the car wash. There's the one as you come over the bridge.
Yep, that's right. Left-hand side.
The one by the car wash.
Yeah, you're right.
There's one by Rockies.
Yep.
And there's one across the street, almost from Rockies.
It's a double across.
That's right.
Three, four, yeah.
Okay, yeah, they are there.
See, you don't even miss them.
Well, no, you just take it.
Billboards should be phased out through amortization and removal under the authority of the Massachusetts Outdoor Advertising Board.
There are towns that are able to get rid of the billboards. We can look into see what the process is.
We've knocked out a lot of big signs in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I get a different feeling from you guys with signs, because a sign is really, with businesses today, they need that sign to promote their business.
Well,
and you guys, you're proud of knocking it out. I'm not proud of you guys.
I think Florence Savings Bank is probably doing pretty good.
Yeah, they could do without
that sign. No, a lot of the other businesses.
Yeah.
The biggest signs.
I mean, what I would rather see are smaller decorative signs that direct you to businesses that are off of the main road, but they're nicely done and they're not, you know, enormous.
But I mean, when they're traveling 40 miles an hour and they get a little sign like this, how the hell?
Rather than
can't even read it.
That doesn't work.
But you know, it didn't keep Kmart in business. It didn't keep Zayers in business. It didn't keep Woolco in business.
No. It's not a joke. It's reality. That's an excellent point.
He don't care.
It didn't keep them in business, and it didn't put them out of business either.
John, once again, every time we go to increase the size of signs to the town meeting, we're overwhelmingly shot down.
Yeah.
And
they're going to be overwhelmingly shot down when all the businesses shut down, and they're going to
I don't think that's going to happen.
Oh, okay.
I don't think, as long as Northampton and Amherst.
Okay.
Back to the rest of this.
Okay.
I got to give him some crap anyways.
Enhance the town center as a livable, workable, and walkable community center.
You all done with the billboards?
Yeah. Unless you have something more to add?
No.
Okay.
They don't bother me at all.
And I think, you know, we've done a lot of good work with the Village Center. I think the design guidelines came out really well.
I think that whoever is writing this has a different vision of what the Village Center is than what Hadley's Village Center is. You know, we are not... we're not Hatfield. We're not South Hadley.
Yep.
Our Village Center is a crossroads.
Yep.
It was the commercial and business heart of the town, but it's not.
It was.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
But it is not and hasn't been for a long time a Norman Rockwell painting.
Yep.
And I don't know, is that really, there's a lot to be gain by trying to go back to something like that, something it never was. I don't think it ever was. You know, there are certainly parts. Middle Street is very walkable on its extremities, but there, even if you wanted to walk out of your house on Middle Street, step onto the sidewalk and walk to what?
Yeah.
Town Hall, Cumberland Farms.
Yeah.
You know, there are only so many.
But that's, you know, what the Village Center is supposed to be. It has, you know, it has mixed uses that gives you someplace to walk to.
Yeah. But it's not today. Yeah. And I don't ever envision Hadley getting there.
Yeah.
We should simply strengthen what we have, because trying to Bill's point, trying to make it something that it isn't.
Yep.
Is a lesson in futility.
Yes.
But don't you think too, Jim, that in that center district, there's land available for, say, a medical center there that people could walk through and stuff like that? There's, you know, I mean, they knocked down some houses, cleared the land.
All of those things, yes, and that would be fine. But to make the center of Hadley like the center of South Hadley or the center of any of those, it's never going to be that way.
Yeah.
You said some of this.
Only one reason. Route 9.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Some of this contemplates that what we're going to have are two- and three-story buildings with retail on the first floor, a restaurant, an office on the second floor, and apartments on the third floor.
Right. Everything would change if they buried Route 9.
You know.
Then it could happen.
No.
Yeah.
They did it in Boston.
Yep. Yep.
Are you talking about another tunnel?
First tunnel.
Well, you're right, Bill. That's exactly what it is. Yeah.
You know.
And there, for the reasons John and Eve and you have noticed, nobody wants, nobody's clamoring to live on Route 9.
That's very true.
And it's, I think it's one of those, if you build it, they won't necessarily come.
Yeah.
I know that I'm very happy to have my office where it is with access via a signalized intersection. I would not want an office on the second floor. First of all, I have to worry about, if I have offices on the second floor, they have to be handicapped accessible now, presumably.
Yep,
so that's
going
to mean it's going to be a very expensive building to have an elevator going to the top.
Yeah.
And it's going to be on Route 9 where I'm going to have people trying to pull out of a driveway through traffic. I just don't see that as a viable goal.
Yeah.
Well, it's a lot of places you go to. They got a main road there, but they also got a service road that makes it, you know, like even up there on, where is it, the UMass Drive there, right? University Drive? The service road that's stepped out that makes all the businesses and people safe without going through that.
On the contrary, that's the biggest zoo going.
Service road on Route 9.
Well, it could be a back road, like Rebel Street there. That could be a service road. You know. But it just, you don't have the land there, you know, behind the school.
Yeah, no, it's a tough call.
So I'd also go back to the fact that, you know, getting critical work with town state elected to assure that Route 9 takes into account the needs of Hadley residents. Certainly the needs as expressed through the original zoning bylaw and the original zoning map,
yeah,
which I think I've shared a copy with you, but if I haven't, I can send you one. Route 9, Russell Street was designated as the business district intentionally in 1960.
Mm-hmm.
And there may be...
And that was logical.
Yeah, you may not want people going so quickly that they can't turn off to go into your store, but you know, again, I don't... livable, workable, walkable all sounds good, but in practice, I just don't think it's us.
That's the same thing the selectmen did way back then to push that sewer down Route 9. It's for the business.
Mm. Well, that
happened.
Where else would you put it?
Development follows sewers.
Yeah.
Page 2, picture. I think that's Hatfield.
I don't know.
And agricultural lands.
Yeah.
Doesn't say Hadley. Question mark.
Yeah.
Where are you now, Joe?
That's your page
right
2.
There.
Oh, I thought we passed that.
No. That picture is Fairfield.
What is that? Is it Ronan Farm? That's a conflict. Get that off of there. Where is that picture, Joe?
South Street, Hatfield.
Yeah, you know, and if you look at the key strategies at the bottom, that's exactly what they're talking about. You know, mixed use.
South Street and Hatfield.
Traditional neighbor development.
Is that your land over there? Oh, see, I knew there was something there. Good old Joe.
You know, which again, if you're talking about, you know, the old New England Town Village Center, that's what the old New England Town Village Centers were. But you're unique. You have such an intrusive element. It's hard to put lipstick on it.
It'd be one thing if my wife and I drove through old Deerfield.
Old Deerfield, yeah, I know.
On Sunday.
I almost said that one. But.
That's fine.
Yeah.
But if Route 5 went...
It would not be like that.
Went down that main street there,
yeah.
It would...
I mean, same in Hatfield. If they had taken, you know, 5 and 10, or whatever the number is there, and didn't have it bypassed and had it run instead through the center of Hatfield, that would be the same issue.
Yeah. Or if Hatfield had put the sewer plant in where it originally proposed, that 5 and 10 would have been extension of King Street.
Yep.
Didn't have sewer.
Yep. That's true. Well, I think that's a good point. Okay, what else do we have? Ensure new development is in keeping with the character of Hadley's landscape and architecture. We've already done the design guidelines.
What are you now, Larry?
I'm sorry.
16.
I've turned the page to 16.
Goal 3.
2 to yeah. 16, back to 2, back to 1.
Larry, come on.
Okay, so we did that.
Although there is the word the committee appears there, and it appears nowhere else, and I don't know what that refers to.
Oh, I know what it refers to. I bet this is how it was worded in the draft that was done, the current plan, where you had a committee. You had the master plan committee?
Okay.
I think it's been purged every place but there.
Okay. Glad it could help.
Yep. Okay. Key strategies. Create walkable, attractive New England village center or downtown style development. Establish design review committee and guidelines. You are sort of the design review committee.
Yep.
Adopt green development performance standards. Adaptive reuse and infill development. Do you have a lot of underutilized or vacant buildings?
No.
I'm trying to think of where I see.
There's a few.
Tobacco barns, sure, we're tearing them down, though.
Promote home occupations and cottage industries.
We have that.
Yeah.
I don't think we want to promote them.
Well, it kind of gets back to the incubator issue or idea, which is, give people who can't afford to rent a place, run it out of their home for a while. God forbid, if they become successful, almost, then they have to move on.
Almost anybody that's running a home occupation, I will, with very few exceptions, will never expand beyond it.
Yeah.
That I can think of.
But there's still a lot.
I don't know. We've had...
There's still a lot.
We had a person.
Harold Eaton and Associates.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's a good example.
Yeah, what?
There was a...
I said there's a few.
Yeah.
I didn't say there was none.
What did you say, Randy?
Bill said that Harold Eaton and Associates expanded. We used to be on Sunrise Drive in our house.
Yeah.
And we moved out to Route 9 because we had too many employees, and my parents figured somebody's going to call the cops on us pretty quick because we had half the street taken up with vehicles.
What did you go?
Hey, I never complained.
No, but you couldn't see that.
How about something from a political nature? 61A, 5 acres. Could we encourage open space by saying if we in 61A to 3 acres and make the 2-3 acre parcels, they don't have to be touching, it can be relatively close.
For what? So you can get more developers?
So you could reduce the tax rate to maintain open space, agricultural land.
I don't think you could do that without changing the state law.
That's 61A state law.
So. I know, but...
I mean, you could reduce the lot size to 3 acres, but I don't think that's going to let you give them the tax program that they're entitled to if they have the 10 acres.
I realize it's a state law, but should we encourage our state legislatures to do something like this, or is that's not what we should put in our goals?
The only thing I'd like to encourage in legislation, that developers that buy farmland and put it under 61A just use it for a tax shelter. That's what I would like to see discouraged, because they're doing that all over.
That's true.
That's right, that's true. So they paid a 5-year...
That's the thing, everybody does that.
But then they're getting away for 10, 20 years, they're investing in it.
Yep.
Better than money in the bank.
Well, we have the case of a gravel operation. They buy a mountain. They start removing the gravel from the mountain over here. The whole rest of the mountain they put under Chapter 61,
yep.
Forestry. when it's time to renew that, they figure out, well, over the term of the next forest management plan, how much more gravel are we going to need? Oh, here? Okay. Then we'll only put this much now under the forestry and get the tax. And they do that until eventually the whole mountain's gone because they've removed it. And for most of that time period, they paid peanuts on taxes because they put it under the protection of, the, of that program. That's sort of an extreme,
so why,
but it happens.
Why isn't that program changed? Nobody wants to say
it's a sacred cow.
A sacred cow. It's not very sacred to me because I see what they're doing.
I am a huge fan of the APR program. I think it's terrific. It's paying you the fair market value for the development rights of your property.
Well, a lot of farmers don't like it. You're not a farmer.
No, I understand that. 61A is just a temporary tax relief program.
It doesn't
necessarily preserve it in the long
term. I still don't like that 61A going to developers.
Yeah, no.
That have no intentions of farming and don't care nothing about farming.
Yep, I don't disagree with you, John. Four, protect, enhance, and strengthen agricultural lands.
So a major comment I had here was this, again, seems to ignore the APR, which is...
Yep.
And 61A, for that matter.
What did you want to
do? It's goal four, so it was just the bottom of the page we were just on. I have different numbering on mine.
Yeah, it talks about the TDR, but it doesn't talk about that. You are correct. Uh-oh. Where's this picture from? I was like, Hadley to you, or?
Like Edward Matus go out towards UMass.
No.
That's hard to say where that is.
Is that Mount Warner?
No, that's the mountain range, east and west, isn't it?
Hard to say.
It may not be.
That ain't Mount Warner Range. That's the Mount Oil Range, isn't it?
There are only two mountain ranges in the United States.
Well, if it's Hatfield, it's the hills that head out towards Bermuda.
This is going to be vegetables, so it has to be a North Hadley. And it's a big piece of land. It's build the wire. What's that look like? Tudin Farm?
Yeah. No, not with the mountain.
Not with that mountain, no.
That is Mount Holyoke with that V cut in there, but this right to the far west, that looks like Mount Warner right there. So would this be the Tudin Farm?
But facing which?
No, Tudin Farm would have
facing south?
Mount Warner.
Yeah, if you were off on 47 with the river off to your right that would be fine. But it looks like there are houses down there.
Yeah, so
correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, well.
Okay. Oh, well. That's
a Mr. Photo. Mr. Photo. And then the key strategies for farmland preservation, strengthen the TDR program, agricultural preservation residential district, create a new residential zoning district for agricultural preservation residential use. The district would replace the existing agricultural residential district with a new district. It would promote preservation of the best farmland areas with any new residential development, within any new residential development. Require agricultural buffers and no build areas when a residential development is proposed adjacent to actively farmed land.
So again, that comes into that. Constraints map that you did.
Yeah.
I'm just not sure that's.
But is this all? Is this also talking cluster without using the word cluster? Are we at the next one? Review subdivision plans for farmland impacts required adjacent agricultural land uses.
It sounds wonderful, but
to be identified on subdivision plans. Utopian.
It is because farmers are looking for large chunks, and the small farmers. You know, the tractors are bigger. You need more acreage to sustain a living. So
there's a scale of economy.
That's correct.
Yeah, you're right.
So the other 2 points, lease town-owned land to farmers, I'm not sure there's much in that category at all. And then the Agricultural Preservation Fund is, in fact, that is what we do with our TDR money.
Yep.
Every penny we get from TDR goes basically to the Conservation Commission to be the town match for APR.
You are right.
I still can't understand that TDR. How does that relieve the parking? When you take up parking, they can remove parking and build a building. So you get TDR in the agricultural fund, but you never correct the problem, the future problem of parking.
What do you mean by that?
Well, when you build a building, they make it more dense and take up more parking lot. It ain't got 2-to-1. So if they pay TDR, somehow they're forgiven with the parking and they can do it.
So in most in most cases, our and that's why it's a special permit. In a lot of cases, I should say, the two to one becomes excessive at the larger end. You know, you rarely find the Hampshire Mall parking lot full or the Mountain Farms Mall full. So when you're talking about 100,000 square feet, having 200,000 square feet of parking is probably excessive most of the time.
Right.
On the other hand, when you're talking about 1,500 square feet, having 3,000 square feet of parking is not necessarily excessive. So that's why for some projects that might come in front of us, we wouldn't consider a TDR reduction in parking because there's no place to put it.
And it's probably a small enough project that it's not going to generate that, so much money anyway.
That TDR still is a special permit, so
yes,
it's not automatically granted for anybody.
Yeah, that's correct.
They've
got to show that they don't need it, and we have to agree that they don't need it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I mean, in order for really any TDR program to work, you need that one requirement that gives you leverage and allows you to use it as a trade-off.
And the parking is a good one.
Yeah, the parking's a good one. In fact, I was reading in some other part of the state, I think it was like in Virginia, trying to figure out how they did theirs successfully. And they said right in it. No, you need to have, you know, one requirement that really gives them a lot of incentive to get around it. And yours works famously.
But, you know, anticipation, you look at Lowe's parking lot, we thought it was too big, but
yep.
Texas Roadhouse is...
It was too big for Lowe's.
Too big for Lowe's, yeah, that's true.
But Texas Roadhouse is filling that end of the parking lot up just fine.
Yeah, but you know, you're right. You know, most parking requirements require parking for 1 month, you know, from Thanksgiving to New Year's.
Correct.
And that's it. And then from then on, the rest of the other 11 months, it's, you know, 66% empty.
Yeah, we intentionally aim high because we don't have any other place to put the parking.
Yep, you're right.
So you have to absorb your own parking.
Yeah. Some of the, you know, not to pick on Amherst, but we put their that building in the corner of Amity Street.
Oh boy.
With virtually no parking. And you know, you always hear about the complaints in Amherst. Where are you gonna park? Where are you gonna park? And we don't need it. We don't need this. We don't, you know, go ahead in Amherst and go there at 8 o'clock in the morning or 9 o'clock at night, you probably can find a place to park. But go there on a weekend during normal hours and find some place to park that's not a 4 mile, well, not a 2 mile walk.
Yeah.
Yeah. Monday morning when school is not in session, it's usually easy to find a parking place.
So.
Yeah.
Okay, I will take these comments back. And I don't think they're not without.
Thank you for your guidance.
Very good.
We did have the open space.
Next time you come back.
Oh, yes. And this one is very, very small. 1, 2, 3. Here's some. Bill, did you print one up already?
I printed
one. All right.
And comments.
I only have. Really. Well, that's a very small section because the Conservation Commission has recently developed a new open space plan. So once they get that adopted, we're just going to plug that in.
That was where I noticed I don't know how they defined open space, but in the 2014 open space and recreation plan, they identified 347 acres of private land protected through conservation restrictions,
yep.
which is what led me to go check my 2,500 acres in APR, and I'm not quite sure. And the Mass Audubon data said that only 1,200 acres of land were protected and had the. I'm not sure. Maybe they're not talking about ag land. Maybe they're talking about something else.
Ag land, again, would be covered under the Agricultural and Natural Resources chapter.
Okay, so
but your open space, you know, this is where it's tough, where you have to be working with the way the state has it all divided by chapter. Because, in fact, your open space recreation plan oftentimes does include your farmland.
In fact,
the
plans are to protect Hadley's agricultural lands.
Yeah.
That's the
yeah.
first goal of the open space
yeah.
recreation plan. So there's just a disconnect there.
Yeah.
You know, I don't like this thing right here when he said prioritize areas around Fort River, Mill River, Connecticut River for habitat protection and wildlife. But yet when the federal government or the state comes in, they can do what the hell they want. There's like two sets of rules. And
oh, there's more than that.
I see, we're in the back page here.
Oh yeah, no.
I see what they do, they bought Mount Warner, they blast trails through that deer habitat there. And Fort River, the Silvio Conti Refuge, put walking trails, walkways within the wetlands, endangered species habitat there. But it's okay for them to do it. Anybody else, a farmer does it or someone, they're ready to put that person in jail. I don't, that kind of stuff I don't like. If we got to abide by the rules, same as the federal government and the state has to, but they can basically do what they want. They want to put a bike path by the river? No problem. Plow it right through. Somebody else wants to do something, and they got a big problem with it.
They could put rattlesnakes in the Quabbin.
Well,
not yet.
I'm not worried about the rattlesnakes.
That's on pause.
You know, the recreational resources, you got Mount Water, Oil Creek, a lot of people just park and walk on the dike.
You actually have parking spaces there, don't you? Don't you
well,
have the Alexander Dawson?
It's kind of
something
not,
or other.
They should have never
much.
Allowed them to walk on that dike.
Yep, but not
because that could start erosion and collapse the dike.
Yeah, but I think it's isn't that like a designated? I think there's a sign there.
Well, I don't know who did it, but that was the selectman, I think, did that.
But the town doesn't own that.
What?
The town does not own the dike.
No, that's private property all the
right.
way to the river.
Right.
Not the feds?
They have an easement.
The town has an easement.
No.
The town's
right.
private property.
Right.
Yeah.
So the town can't.
But people walk through. Farmers saying to go down and steal their products through the
well,
well, there are always cars parked here.
In Hatfield, it's amazing how many people walk that dike. Doing
yep.
some work there. It's so that 55 and older housing project with the center school.
Yeah,
I think that's
no, that's
fall.
True.
Who developed the parking lot right next to East West Street Common around there? Who did that? The selectmen allowed that. Had they take that right out, you wouldn't have all those people.
I wonder if they actually, if the town actually owns that section at the end between.
West Street?
At the end of West Street.
Yeah, I bet you're right.
I think the town probably does own the, when you are driving north on West Street and you're forced to turn, I think the town owns the dike at that spot.
The people don't congregate there. They go
right.
all
no, no,
the
they,
way
they,
down.
But they park there.
Right.
And I think there's a sign there. It's an Alexander Dawson
yeah, that's
conservation land or something like that.
Further along. But there's
yeah.
a stretch in there.
Okay.
That is, I think, town owned.
She was against all this stuff with wetlands and everything, and yet she wants people to trash all along through there.
Well, I'm not sure she's aware of it now.
Yeah.
She was aware of it before. She was alive when that all happened.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, that's it for now.
Thank you very much. We'll look at this and...
That sounds good. Shall we see in a month?
Yes.
Yes.
The next time you come back, make sure you have copies for everyone.
Oh, I almost did.
Make a good little...
I only did it on that one. That was...
We're not going to get away with it. Good little Larry.
Very good. Well, A&R?
No.
No?
Something even less.
You should have got here earlier.
I would like to have, but I had to go to a birthday party.
Very good.
I waited.
See you later.
No,
thanks.
I got there. I said, oh. I looked in the backseat of my truck. I said, well, I can't go back from South Hadley to Hadley, so I'll just have to come late.
What you got?
Mr. Burkue and Gooseberry Lane. He has an article on the town meeting warrant to get it accepted as a town way. Mr. Nixon tells me the planning board needs to look at the plans. And so what is the protocol for this?
What does it mean, look at the plan?
Well,
so I think he is...
As-built plans.
I think
as-built.
It has been referred to us already. The Burkue started this process the same we went through with...
Camilla.
With, with Camilla and with the folks on...
Holly.
On Holly. Where a petition or a request to accept the road has been sent to the select board. They have sent us a letter. We replied either in writing or verbally that we lacked sufficient information because this plan didn't exist. And so they're going through the process of how to get this road accepted as a town way.
Right.
So why don't you show us what you've got?
Is this an as-built plan?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So everything on that plan you're putting down here is supposed to be where it is?
It is where it is.
Who verified it?
We, after the road is built, we go and locate everything. That is...
Did this have a peer review?
When it was built, it would have. So I don't understand why they want you guys to look at it, quite frankly.
Well, we'll look at it.
But so what you see is the edge of pavement. There's water gates there. There are catch basins, leaching basins, water lines.
So
there are the town. The DPW requires us to put distance ties off the corners of the houses to the water gates so they can find them if there are issues. And again, DPW has copies of this, and Town Hall has copies of this.
So if you verified everything, then what is it really doing here for?
We are part of, we're a stop on the process for a road to be accepted by the town.
Okay.
This goes back a while. One of the things was to make sure that we have an as-built plan, which is the biggest thing to accepting a road as a town road. Make sure that an as-built has been given completed, if you would.
And there are concrete bounds set at all the changes in direction of the roadway.
This map verifies you did everything according to the original. This is the part of the original plan.
That just shows you how it was done in relation to the original plan.
Okay. So this is the final.
The DPW, was there a catch basin problem here?
I don't believe so. I haven't heard anything.
Was that a different street?
It must have been something different.
That might have been on Bayberry.
The only thing I can think that I know of is they told me that one of the water gates must have been hit by a plow or something, so it's bent. But so they'll require the applicant to fix that before they'll be satisfied.
Okay, so you did check with them. That's a critical step, I think.
Yeah.
So
if they're happy, we're happy.
This is an easement for drainage out here?
Yep.
Yes.
Is there a written document?
It will be part of what is brought before town meeting. If I haven't seen it, but typically what happens is there's a description of the road right-of-way, and any easements pertinent to the project are part of that description that gets accepted at town meeting.
That's...
Yes, because that, I mean, I'm sure that this, this lot, I think that's Lisa Sanderson's.
Yep.
So her deed will have...
Subject to.
Subject to that easement. But I understand your question. The town needs to have a document that gives them the right to use it as it's proposed.
Right, otherwise it's just floating out there.
Right, yeah, so I would, again, I'm assuming that it's going to be part of the document that gets voted on at town meeting, but I have not seen the legal description. This one, they didn't ask me to write one for, so I don't know who did it, but I would hope that town council would catch it.
Would you just remind, perhaps, Attorney McConnell's office that it should be there?
Sure. I have to see him tomorrow, so...
So, I'm not quite sure where we are. I had all of the, for Holly and, for Holly, I had all of the checklists out on what we had to do. I have put those away. I don't know if we want to take them out. I'll make a motion to accept the as-built plans.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously.
Do you want a copy for your records, or do you want a digital copy?
Both. Copy would be good. Yeah, give us one. Drop one up. Get this one.
He's going to drop it right now.
Okay, so just so this doesn't get lost in the shuffle, and I know Berkeley's been waiting quite a while for this to happen, do you have to file something with the select board?
I think we don't at this point, because the sequencing got out of... We have like 60 days to reply after we get the letter from the select board. And if we don't reply, it's considered not to be an objection.
Okay.
Well, can't you just let it call Nixon and say the board voted for it?
Oh, yeah, we'll do it. We'll do it. I just don't think it's required.
Okay.
I don't think...
Well, it doesn't make no
difference. That's fine, right. I just want to make sure we don't miss a step here. Somebody would be very unhappy with me. All right, that's all I have, gentlemen. Thank you very much. Okay. Have a lovely evening.
Okay. Good. Before you do that, got an email from the town accountant. They want, we have had several incidences where invoices being paid from a departmental appropriation have been signed by someone within the department or from another department that should not have been authorized to put an invoice in for payment. So they're now asking us to sign and return a form saying who can sign invoices on behalf of, in our case, the planning board.
We've been putting invoices in for the planning board, or this for other departments?
This is to everyone.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, every single department.
What do you mean? Somebody's in conflict of signing?
The purpose is simply to identify authorized signers per department, as well as to provide a sample of the signature for us to compare on invoices when need be.
Oh, boy.
For many of you who are department heads, you may be the only signer. So that's why this this came up. You know, for decades, literally, we have been voting invoices individually. And I don't know if it would be worthwhile just to take a vote to authorize the chairman to approve invoices under, how much is the Gazette?
It was $29.
Okay. What's the most the Gazette?
$700-$800. No. This chairman does not wish to sign individual invoices unless this board approves them. Period.
Okay.
good idea.
Because I don't want that to bite me.
Right.
Or whoever else might be the chairman.
Although some things like the Gazette invoice is an obligation once we send it in. We don't vote to authorize you to send
whose
it in.
Whose idea was to do this?
Town accountant.
What's the difference if all of us sign it? Is nobody in conflict?
I don't think they've had a problem with this board.
That's correct.
I think the problem is because anything that we have ever paid in the last, Gordon Board, 30-something years that I've been on this board, we have all signed it. And all approved it. Maybe we necessarily didn't say a motion to endorse, but we have all signed it, mm-hmm. whatever it is. And...
Yeah, there were no minutes.
I don't think we've had a problem. I don't think the accountants had a problem with this.
Oh, no, no.
But it's probably with other boards that, well, you pay this or pay this, whatever it may be.
Yeah.
So
we're going to go through and do as asked. We're going to sign this and...
Say we'll the full board...
But the question was whether it would simplify things to not have to have everybody sign every invoice. But if you...
He just got done telling you he's not uncomfortable doing it, so let's all sign it.
The majority of the board, to say, in
yeah.
case,
well, right.
instead of saying all if somebody's missing board, a meeting.
So you don't know who's going to be the majority, so everybody sign it.
Right. What if you're not here?
So everybody sign it. That way you got the majority board. Majority rules anyway.
Okay, that's what I'm saying.
So you don't even need that. Otherwise you don't have the majority, you don't have a meeting. Right,
Michael? All right. Yeah.
All right,
well,
chairman wants something, he gets it.
No, chairman doesn't want to get
you.
Doesn't want
no,
to get
you. No, you wanted everybody sign it.
That's right.
So there it is.
Yes. That way, if one person is guilty, we're all guilty.
Exactly.
So, well,
we'll all go to jail.
One person
we'll all get three meals on the roof over
there. There you go.
So,
now you think buddy-buddy.
Well, that's getting done before we vote on that. Email came in from inviting us to sign up for a Chapter 40B workshop to be held September 19th. That's next week.
Next week? 2 weeks.
2 weeks. In Northampton, the event is free, but space is limited. A light dinner will be served.
Cheese and crackers.
Monday, September 19th from 6 to 8:30. So Chapter 40B is the comprehensive permit law. We don't have a direct role in comprehensive permits. Those automatically go to the ZBA. But the invitation came to the planning board. Is anyone interested in going to that?
I think I put something in for them, but I don't know if they received it. I'm going to call them.
Okay.
I'll call them. I'm sorry.
So, just there's no charge, but you have to sign up for it.
Oh, I can't do the 19th. I got a conflict. Sorry.
Where that's in hand?
Construct.
Yeah. I'll go to that.
So it's not, as I said, not directly applicable to us. See if you can get John Kukoski or someone to go with you. Okay, Chapter 40. Seminar 9/19/16 in Northampton. John might attend. Did you want to?
Yes.
Zoning bylaws.
Yes. Did you pretend you emailed them, right?
I did.
Yeah.
I emailed these around to everybody, but. The three changes, I double checked
the three changes regarding taking off the renewal of the special permits, double-check those, they look fine, except I wonder if you wanted to just, instead of renumbering the following three subsections, just say reserve for future use.
Yeah, that makes more sense.
Because that's what you had done on the other one, too.
Okay, that makes sense, yeah.
And on the other one, I double-checked everything, and I just saw that said 30,000.
Oh, 30,000, yep, okay.
And then down here, in the aquifer protection, I think it, you want to have it
per the underlying
district for those two categories, too.
Right, okay.
And other than that, I'll give you this.
Okay, yeah, that'd be good. Give me this one, too, so I'm going to do it the right way.
Yeah, and then I'll send a revised copy around to everybody.
Okay. When's town meeting?
October 27th, yeah.
Okay, so I'll schedule a public here. I think I had something on. Do we have a fall town meeting set?
You got to do 20 days prior to the town meeting?
No, we usually try to schedule at one of our meetings.
No, in this case, we don't. The only reason we have to do it 20 days prior is if we don't want to have to take a vote.
It doesn't have to be 20 days. It can be the day before.
No.
If we're prepared to take a vote, I think it's early. I think it's early, like the 6th. 6th or the 13th?
What?
Town meeting, fall town meeting.
No, the 6th.
Usually it's early in May.
No.
Oh, right here. 27th day of October, okay. 2016.
Okay.
So we can do it on the 18th or the 4th, whichever one I can hit it for.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So we're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4 articles. Yep. Okay.
Department and submission. Okay, Mike, you're supposed to sign up here.
That's fine. That's not a problem.
Okay.
We have a bill to pay $29.08 to the Daily Hampshire Gazette for legal notice. For which one is this for? This is for the special public hearing for the one we just had last for Knightley Road stuff.
So moved.
Motion?
Second.
A second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion passes unanimously. John?
Yeah. I'd like just announcement on North Hadley Thursday, the 19th, the ZBA hearing. I'd appreciate everybody if they would.
Oh, this month?
Yep.
Okay.
Appreciate everybody that would support the substation there. And also the opposition. I know I plan to oppose the studio apartments in the North Hadley Hall. That's going to be right before There are two hearings back to back. It's the 19th. On the 19th.
Well, that'll be the day after our next meeting.
No, the 7 o'clock at night.
That'll be the next day after our next meeting, so you can remind us on that meeting, too.
And then also,
the 19th, that's the day before our meeting, I'm sorry.
Okay, so that's the same.
Yeah, that's during the day. This is 7 o'clock at night.
This is at night, 6 to 8:30 p.m.
Oh, well, I'm not going to that. Also, we're putting together a retirement party for Mike Komofsky.
He's going to retire?
Yeah, he submitted his retirement, and the selectman accepted it.
Wow.
October 7th, he'll be at the Young Men's Club Pavilion. I think the cost is going to be like $20 a head. It'll be a chicken dinner, and that's including the gift for him. I mean, he's 42 years of service to the town.
What year was October 7th? That's a Friday night?
Yeah. Okay. Who's Cody at? Probably my kid and somebody else. I'm going to get red light on those guys.
Okay. That's it?
Yeah, that's it. That's what I got.
Joe?
All set.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting's history. Thank you, and thank you, Miranda.